Okay. My name is Tamima Faruqi, and I'd like to welcome you guys to our Job Resource Center presentation on resumes and cover letters. At the Job Resource Center, we have a wide variety of services you'll see on your bookmark, as well as on our website. We offer job listings on our College Central network system. We offer appointments for not only students, but also alumni. You can make an individual 30-minute appointment, or perhaps you need a little bit more time. Just let us know when you're scheduling that appointment, and we can sit down with you and really tailor that resume. We offer, of course, day and evening workshops. Our evening workshops are a little more geared toward the community, and they're 2.5 hours longer, so a little more in depth. We do have a wonderful non-traditional career program that really encourages men and women to look at fields outside of the box, such as men in nursing or women in welding. We have a wonderful internship program. I highly encourage all of you to really look into that. And Marie Harrell is the internship manager for that program. Job-related events. Twice a year, we host two major events, something called Mock Interview Day. I don't know if any of you have heard of that. That's when we invite volunteer employers who are hiring experts to come and practice with you. So you come dressed up like it's the real thing, and you get 30 minutes of that valuable time with that employer. And I don't know about you, but when we go on interviews, it's pretty rare that we get the full information. Have you ever asked an interviewer, how did I do? You know, sometimes they're not able to tell you exactly how you did. You're going to get the honest feedback, that valuable feedback at our mock interview day events. So our next one is in February, but we also offer them in September. That matches up with our job and internship fair that we host in March, and then again in September or October. So please look for that. We are the HR for student employment as well, if you're interested in working on campus. Okay. So our mission of the Job Resource Center is essentially to connect you, the students, alumni, and the community to really connect to job and internship opportunities. That's the essence of our role. On our website, it has another website that I'd like to draw your attention to. If you haven't done so already, you want to register on College Central Network. This is our network that hosts a wide variety of services. When employers call us and they want to post a job and they want to post it with Moraine Valley, they're going to be directed to this site. As you can see, there's a button for employers. Now, we share the site with about 12 other area colleges. So some of the jobs that are posted in the area colleges will also be visible to you. So you can filter it in different ways. So we do have a workshop on this, or you can make an appointment and we can help you with this as well. Another cool feature with College Central is that it offers you a resume builder. Has a quick resume builder. You can input your information and upload it so employers can see it. You can also upload whatever you create in Word as well. So really nice site. And let's see, today we're gonna talk about the resume and cover letter. But first, before we get to that, I just want to reiterate how important it is to really know yourself and be able to articulate those wonderful qualities that each of you have. You know, there's no one else like you, there'll never be another one of you, right? And each of you has different experiences, different directions you're heading to. So at the Job Resource Center, we can't say, this is the only way, or there's one perfect cookie cutter way to create this marketing tool. Essentially, the resume is the best of you, and it's very strategic, it's tailored. So it's going to be different for each of you. So let's see how we get there. You do have a packet accompanying that. This packet is available on our website under resources, as well as other handouts. So we'll use that as we talk today. Okay, so if someone can tell me, why do we need a resume and a cover letter? Most jobs ask for an application. Why do you think we need a resume or cover letter?
There's so many people out of work, and there's so few jobs available, so you have to make a name for yourself.
You have to sell yourself, right? Regardless of what is going on out there, we have to just focus on ourselves and really create something that is going to highlight those skills. Now, in a job application, it kind of forces everyone to put that information in a certain way. Sometimes there's no room to put other information, but your resume is yours. You can create it and structure it however you wish to. So I'm going to talk about three different formats, but it may be tweaked and targeted and a little bit different for each company or field, depending on your needs. So it gives you the freedom. It gives you the freedom to really market yourself. So great. Anybody else? Why do we need a cover letter? Excellent. A quick way for the employer to get to know who you are and your qualities and skills. Actually, it brings life to the resume. So it's the first point of contact sometimes in writing that introduces your resume. Yes, sir.
Isn't that also your opportunity to kind of schmooze them?
Absolutely. And we're definitely going to talk about the schmooze. And we do use that word in there. So great. So what does a good resume and cover letter do for you? It opens doors. It may not get you the job, the interview gets you the job, but it's like a key that unlocks the door. It's also a networking tool. So a resume, according to this famous career coach, Susie Ireland, a resume is not just a list of jobs. It's a picture of who you are. And it's your resume's job to help that employer make it easy for them to say, yes, I'm going to put this in the yes pile and really consider this person. So the first thing I want you all to do is look inward, self-reflection. What are the qualities you have that you can offer an employer? Hi, welcome. What are the qualities you have to offer an employer? What is your brand identity? Have you heard of brand identity? Well, we know what brands are, right? When we think of a famous car company, different models, it gives you a different feeling. You think of Mercedes, you think luxury, perhaps. Or if you think of Nissan, you think of more economical car, cost effective. So when we are out in the world, we are sending off a message. Products and celebrities have brand identities, but we as human beings also have a brand identity. Another word for it is simply reputation. So what's your reputation in the workforce? What's your reputation in your community? So every time we meet people, whether it's even at the Jewel or in class, we're leaving seeds of our reputation. Does that make sense? A little bit of our legacy. So really think about what you personally have to offer an employer. In general, and then maybe specifically. So the first thing I always like to start off with is addressing the three categories of skills that our employers are looking for. And that is adaptive, transferable, and job-related skills. So adaptive skills are essentially soft skills. They are skills that relate to your work ethic, your personality. Are you friendly? Do you have a positive attitude? Are you somebody I can count on for being on time? Are you dependable? What signals do you send off in the work world or just in your personal life? Transferable skills, especially for those of you who are making a career shift, that's going to be an essential point to concentrate on in your resume. What can you take from your past, present, and connected to the future? So if I were working as a barista making coffee, but my dream job is to become a nurse, what are the transferable skills? Can you see the connection? Can someone identify one?
Customer service.
Excellent. Customer service. Customer relations then translates into patient relations, right? Time management, maybe management leadership skills, if I'm a manager, all sorts of different things. And sometimes we have to be a little more creative about our transferable skills. So can you think of something that will connect your past to your future? Yeah, okay. I would like you to think of at least one for each category. And the third is job-related skills. If I'd like to become a nurse, obviously I have to go through the education, the credentialing, and I need specific skills. If I want to become an office administrator or an assistant, I have to know how to type, right? I have to know certain software and certain office-related matters and so forth. So those are job-related skills, very important. Really think about how did you enhance that company you worked for prior. And if you've never had a job, think about volunteer work as well. How did you make it better? In other words, we're asking you to simply name your strengths. Number one, I want you all to write this down or put it in your memory. What is the best part of your personality as it relates to the world of work? What's the first thing that pops into your head? Okay. Second, what skills did you acquire from previous jobs or opportunities that will connect you to your goal job? Sometimes we have to be a little more creative, but if you really look at your life, I think there's a thread connecting your past, present, and future. I'm a career changer. I worked in graphic design. I still do some graphic design. I worked in marketing and business. And now I'm in higher education. One of the things that connects my past and my future is really my love of seeing something come into fruition. Like I like to see the potential in something, and now it's in someone, my students, and seeing them, you know, really using their skills to the best of their abilities. So it's a little more abstract for me, but think about it in terms of your life too. What's a connecting point? What's a passion for you? And what we're doing here, we're planting the seeds to a really good resume or even a really good interview. And then, of course, if you are in a specific program right now, maybe you're in IT or culinary arts or OSA, what is that program specifically teaching you? Look back at your syllabi if you need to. How will it connect you to the job descriptions? Okay. Then the next thing I'd like you to write down and think about, it's called STAR, and it stands for something. It stands for something that really helps the employer see more of you. If I tell you I'm really patient with people, that's nice. But if I give you a story, if I give you a concrete example of how I'm patient with people, or how I'm effective at customer service, that's gonna be better, right? So one of the mistakes that people make in a resume or cover letter, they don't give enough, or even in an interview. This is very useful in an interview as well. So how are you a star? Think about specific situations where they were challenging. You know, we've all been in some challenging situations, right? Whether on the job or another aspect in our life, maybe in school. And think about that moment where you handled it really well, that you were a star, okay? So S is for situation, T is for task. What did you have to achieve? What was the goal? For example, customer service. Have any of you worked in retail or food service? Yes. Have you ever worked with people, customers? Have you ever encountered people who are a little cranky, crabby? Yes. Yes. Well, I worked at the mall, and I worked at the mall during the holiday season as well, so I have some experience with that. Our goal was to sell perfumes and fragrances. It was a very difficult time because we have a rush of people, which is good for business, but we also have to balance really quality customer care and our goals as well. So the action, what did you do? You know, perhaps you had one situation where you had an upset customer and he or she wanted something of you and it was a dilemma for you. How do I do this and how do I do this? You have to multitask perhaps. So think about what you did. How did you handle it? What were the alternatives? Why did you do it? Very important. And lastly, what do you think the R stands for? Take a wild guess. The most important piece. Pardon me? Resources? Possibly. At the end of the day, when I share something with you, results? Yes? Okay. At the end of the day, positive outcomes are what we're looking for, right? So ask yourself, if you currently have a resume, do you pepper it with results? Are you talking about, you know, how effectively you did something? Are you talking about concrete numbers? How did you make it better? If I say worked in customer service or operated cash register, well, that's okay. But let's take it to the next level. Operated cash register effectively or with meticulous attention to detail. Add a little more. And the more specific you get, the better. So a strong resume, essentially, of course, is clear and free of errors. It's concise, it's brief. It uses language that sells you. You know, as we talk about brand identity, you're the product, and we need to use that marketing language that is sincere but really toots your horn. Yes, sir.
The second item on this says concise and brief.
Mm-hmm.
I've only had two jobs in my entire career. One of them was for 34 years.
Okay.
So how do you make something concise and brief when you've been working for a company for that amount of time, worked your way up the career ladder?
Mm-hmm.
In my case, it was to a second VP in a bank.
Mm-hmm.
Where they had to downsize and let a whole bunch of us go.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my resume is almost close to 3 pages long because I don't know what to keep. I don't know what to take out.
Okay.
Because everything in there to me is important.
Excellent question. Question is, if a resume is 2-3 pages long, if you worked only one or two places, and you've moved up in that organization, you know, that is challenging. However, what I'd like you to do is put yourself in the shoes of that future employer and ask yourself, bullet by bullet, is this relevant? Is this really necessary? Or is this assumed? What can I leave out and still keep it at a relatively, you know, a decent page number? For you, probably at an executive level, a two-page resume is appropriate. There are certain fields, like in education, my CV is 4 pages long or so. But it's always best to ask yourself, line by line, is this really necessary? Another trick I have for you is something called LinkedIn. Are you familiar with LinkedIn, linkedin.com? It allows you to put all of that down there. And what you can do is take that personalized URL, the website, and put it in your resume or cover letter and have that employer, please, you know, look at this for more information. So that's one of the hints I have.
So you're saying use LinkedIn and incorporate it into your resume?
Mm-hmm. You can, under your contact information, and I'll show you that, you can just put it under your email address. You can do that, and you may also show it in your cover letter. Basically, we're redirecting them. You want to learn more, you can go on this site. So the advantage of that is if you're really using LinkedIn effectively, you have a network, people are recommending you, they've written nice things about you on there. So you want them to look at that site, ideally. So that's another workshop unto itself. But really ask yourself, how can I be strategic about the information I'm putting here? I have to do that with my resume too. Sometimes I'm stating things that is assumed at, you know, at my level, entered data. I don't need to put that on there, for example. So really be strategic and think about that employer's needs, okay? So in a basic resume structure, it's gonna kind of look like this. We have about an inch margin. I mean, it could be a little bit less. There's no absolutes. There are very few, I should say. First thing is your name is gonna be a larger font size. So aesthetically, it's clean, it's simple. We're using one font style. You can use two font sizes. What do you think is an appropriate font size? 12. You can use 12, 11, but it really is dependent on the style of the font. So Times New Roman, Arial, Helvetica, clean, simple font. So then we have contact information here. You'll typically just have one set. This is someone living off campus as well. Your address, a professional sounding email. I can't stress that enough. Your cell phone or whatever number you're comfortable providing. Make sure that when I, as an employer, call your number, that I'm introduced to you in a very friendly way. Like sometimes we encounter voicemail and it's like, hey, leave a message. You want to sound, enthusiastic or just a little bit friendly. And then you have your email, and that's where you could add your LinkedIn address, your website. So for, I believe my LinkedIn, it's pretty much linkedin.com/Tamima. So typically you'll get some variation of that. Then we'll go into different sections, and your sections are going to be different. Each of you is unique and different. But overall, we typically start with the objective or a summary, and I'm going to get into that a little bit more. Objectives are more and more passé now, because really we're going to have a cover letter. We're always going to have a cover letter, and that's your objective. That's your goal. So if you don't really have room for it or a need for it, reconsider using up that space. This is prime property. Top to bottom, left to right, ask yourself, what is going to help my skills connect to that employer? What's going to really make a difference here? And is that necessary? Sometimes an objective is useful, like if you don't know where you're applying to. And the only time that happens is at a job fair, if you didn't get the list beforehand. So you might do that. Or you're giving it to a friend or someone else to make a soft pass to an employer, and you don't quite know where that's going. So sometimes you can use that. And I'll go into summary. So different categories, there's so many different categories you can have. Military experience, volunteer experience, professional organizations. Anyone join any student life clubs or associations? I know if you've worked for the Glacier, you can incorporate that as an organization and as experience, too. If you've had an internship, an externship, honors, awards, exhibits, and publications. So essentially, I want to break this down as three formats for your resume. You have to decide for yourself, depending on where it's going, which is the most appropriate format. Okay, the first one you're most familiar with, chronological. Okay, basically you're listing your experience section from present to past. Okay, so it's actually reverse chronological. This is the most common, and this is quite simple, and it's very useful for someone who's staying in the same field or they haven't had a whole lot of experience. Functional minimizes the actual work history, but really focuses on skills. Much of the paper, that prime property, that 8.5 by 10 piece of paper, it focuses on skills. And I'll show you how that looks. Combination is a combination of the two. It sections your experiences and clusters it with headings. Okay. If you look in your packet, the resume and cover letter packet, which is also available on our website, you can go to, this is, I believe, page seven. Page seven, Jonathan Depp. Not really, but Jonathan Depp here on page seven, you can see, here's a zoom in on his experience on our screen. He has a very different kind of resume from maybe a person who had similar job experience, and I'm going to show you a different version of this. So as you look at this, can someone tell me what he's currently doing? What is his current job under experience? Yes. And before that, he was a computer sales associate. And before that, he was a volunteer web developer. So he has a limited amount of experience, so we incorporated under experience. Okay. The start of the resume, we've got qualification highlights, education, and so forth. So that doesn't define chronological. It's just what was better for him. You can look at the next page, Surely I Qualify, and that also shows you a different version. So there's no absolute cookie cutter way of doing this. These are meant to just inspire you, kind of serve as a little bit of a guide for your first resume. Then I'd like to direct you to a functional resume. And this is on page nine. Jamila Depp. So if Johnny Depp had a twin sister named Jamila, and she did the exact same jobs, if you jump down to experience, you'll see she did the exact same jobs here. She's also a technology specialist, computer sales associate, web developer. But this looks radically different, doesn't it? The top of it has a summary of qualifications, which is a little bit similar. But much of the page is taken up by skills. And we've visually minimized the actual experience. So why are we doing this? If you look at the top, we give you a hint. Well, Jamila is changing her career. So she realized she didn't want to just stay and behind the scenes fixing computers. She is good at sales. She's an extrovert, and she's discovering some marketing and leadership qualities in herself. And that's where she'd like to end up. That's her goal. So top to bottom, we start off with marketing and sales. What skills did she get? So we use that as a skills header. Then leadership and management. And then information technology, because that was not on the high part of the totem pole, so to speak. Does that make sense? Please feel free to ask if it doesn't. Essentially, we're thinking about the reader. The reader's going to look at the first half of the page first, right? Imagine if you had to hire, you would know 300 resumes come in. How does that feel for someone on the other end? It's quite a process. It's difficult sometimes. And initially, most people are glancing that first half. So your job is to make it easier for their job to pick you, essentially. So think about that. Think about that carefully. And that includes the bolding and italics. Be careful how you incorporate the font style and so forth. Everything about it should be, okay, it's easy to read who you are and what it's about, okay? The third style is called the combination resume. And that's Maya Poppins. My resume is on page 12. This is quite different. So Maya Poppins, Mary's cousin, I guess. She is in childcare. Her passion is childcare. She's also a bit of a career changer. But she holds two different jobs simultaneously. You know, and many times in our lives, we're doing two things at once. So as you can see, what we've done is we've used a header, not child care skills, but child care experience, okay? And her goal is to work in a child care facility, maybe one day become a director of that facility. She's come back to school to retrain and retool. So we focus on these seemingly small jobs. As you can see, what is she doing right now? She's a teaching intern. She's a child care provider. So we took these small jobs and gave them more attention. We spotlit them. Does that make sense? And at the same time, you can see she's also a manager at a retail clothing store. So she's doing both at the same time. This is the opposite of a chronological resume, okay? This is useful, again, for someone who's really trying to make connections with their past and future as well. When I made my first career shift, I used something similar to this. So if you're thinking about something quite different and you're heading in a different direction, consider this. So these are the two headers she chose, because that really connects to the job description to where she's applying. And we wanted to keep this at one page, so we didn't go into detail with her management. Typically, we know what comes with that, and if they want to learn more, they can go on her LinkedIn profile, okay? Do you have any questions on this? This can get a little bit complicated, so if you're a student, we're happy to, you know, sit down with you, just make an appointment with our office, and we can put the puzzle together. Okay, so I mentioned to you objectives are kind of out of fashion. You really need to understand what is the purpose of it. If you're going to use an objective, it really should be captivating. It should be specific. So perhaps for like a nurse, you could say, dedicated professional seeks to apply excellent clinical education in a modern group practice, not just to become a nurse. Does that make sense? So say a little bit about yourself, give yourself a description. Remember that best part of your personality that you all wrote down or filed it in your memory? Perhaps it's that word that's coming to you, okay? And then where do you want to go? Even better though, as you can see from all of our examples in the packet, we use something called a professional summary or qualification highlights. So that allows you to highlight three or four things you're most proud of in your career. If you look back at your career and who you are, what are the three or four things that really come to mind? And what will connect to that employer? It's kind of like a summary of the rest of your resume. So you can either call it qualification highlights, summary, it doesn't matter, but essentially it's three or four. You probably don't want to get more than five. It can be bulleted or it can be in a paragraph format, okay? Think about what else should go next in the section. Remember top to bottom. For some of you, it'll be education. If you're currently a student at Marine Valley, my opinion would probably be that education would come up close to the top, right? And why is that? It's what you're presently doing, and it's fresh. It shows that you are, you know, improving yourself, you're teachable, you're back in school, or you're starting something new. If it connects with the program, it's even better. But you have to use your individual judgment on that as well. After a few years, perhaps that's going to dip back down, you know, on the bottom. So think about how you can strategize and use that space effectively. Okay? Skills, very essential section. And you may title it different things. You can break it down with subcategories as well. How many of you speak another language? Okay. So maybe you have two or three other languages. You can incorporate that as well. How many of you know certain software programs? We all know Microsoft Word, right? So that would go in there, Microsoft Office, different elements there. What you really want to do is look at the job description. that you are, you know, ideally hoping to apply for, or at least a sister version of it. You know, try to look at as many job descriptions as possible with the title you're seeking, and incorporate some of that language here in the skills section, because you want to make sure that you've covered everything that they're looking for. Sometimes a human being isn't even looking at your resume first. Did you know that? A computer is scanning, a software program scanning for keywords. And if they're looking for a Spanish speaker and you forgot to mention that, you know, it's possible that resume is never going to get to an actual hiring manager. So be careful with, you know, omitting very important things that are especially in their job description. When we get to experience, now this is if we do a chronological or combination style, we're going to let them know exactly what we did in that position, okay? I'm a fan of bullets. I think they're easy to read, and most employers I talk to do prefer that, some kind of bullet. It pulls the reader right into the sentence, and we always want to try to start with an action verb, okay? This is in third person, so the I voice, we save it for the cover letter. So what are the action verbs here? Interviewed, gained, assisted, demonstrated, organized. In your packet, we give you 2 pages of action verbs that you can, just to trigger your memory and get going with that. The art of this is to give them enough to want to interview you, you know, to give them enough detail, enough star example, but yet still be concise and not too lengthy. So that, again, is individual discretion, but I would encourage you to have many people look at your resume. Job Resource Center, friends, maybe even an instructor who's in the field. So we typically pick 3 to 5 bullets that really highlight what you did at that position. And then you want to prioritize it in terms of what will connect to that employer. Not everything on your list of duties is going to match up with where you want to go, right? So some things you can omit, but really be careful and think about how you can highlight those skills and the results, the accomplishments. So as you can see here, we say gained experience in procedures such as routine lab tests on over 100. Ever been commended for something? Maybe you didn't get a plaque for it or a big award, but perhaps your supervisor or client or somebody, a customer said, thank you for making my day. And this has been a consistent pattern in your life. You know, feel free to incorporate that. To me, that's highlighting your accomplishments. Have you improved an organization? By you being at that organization, how did you make it better? How did you make it better for your coworkers, your supervisor? And I even give an example of you may be working at Taco Bell and you're wiping down the tables, but you did it better and faster than anybody else. You did it the best of your ability, making it easier for others to do their other tasks. That's on a smaller scale. As we get into management and leadership positions, this is critical. What was your vision? How did you structure that? It gets more in depth. But we all, regardless of our title, we all have moments where we're leaders and we can make an impact on the organization. So try to incorporate some of that. Satisfying customers, building rapport, bringing in people. Maybe you're a really good listener. Maybe you work in IT and you really understand the client's needs. And it's shown time and again in your results because people come to you again and again. Have you innovated? Have you developed a program? And maybe it's not a formal program. Maybe it's just a suggestion that your management tried, you know, something as simple as a filing system. And it made things better. it made things better. So this can be on various scales of titles and leadership and so forth. So think about that. And again, with the STAR concept being a little more specific and results oriented, we want to always try to quantify our results. I mean, you may not be able to do this in every bullet, but at least every other bullet, or I don't know, at least one per job. Think about that. When we see numbers, concrete numbers, it's always best. Where can you get those numbers? Sometimes you have to estimate, but look back at your evaluations, reference letters, things, projects that you've worked on. I've even seen quotes incorporated into the experience section. For example, earned a reputation for excellence in service delivery. Supervisor comments, Mary has outstanding clinical skills. And this could have been pulled from an actual recommendation letter that, you know, can be attached in a career portfolio, or even from LinkedIn. So you can think outside of the box. It's okay. Just ask yourself, is it fulfilling my purpose, my goals and their goals? Is it making a connection to their needs? How is this helping? So far, do you guys have any questions on resumes?
Tons.
Tons. Do you want to try one that I can attempt to answer?
Mm-hmm. And there is no supervisor. In my last two positions, I've had no supervisors.
Mm-hmm.
What do you do?
Well, we focus on your assessment and your client's assessment. I don't know what role you were in.
I was a manager. I was an owner of a restaurant.
Okay. So your results are in the customers. You know, what have customers said about your company, your restaurant? Maybe the client speaks for you. When I did independent contract work, I worked for myself. Who could speak for me but my client? So you might want to incorporate some things that people have said about you, and your leadership style, your vision, how you've effectively managed teams. So there are ways to kind of simply look at yourself and your interaction with other people, subordinates, as well as clients, that you can incorporate. So when you're in that role, we're dependent on your assessment primarily. I hope that kind of answers your question. Anyone else? Yes.
I have a question. You know, like some things like 12 years ago were kind of new, mm-hmm. and now they're like, Mm-hmm. Like when we created a program, we were making modifications to it. Like being a computer programmer, made modifications, and our supervisor was looking for a person that who can go and take it to the client, you know.
Side. Okay.
We had just attended a class where we had learned all that, how to zip files, and I said, we don't need to go, we can zip. Everybody was kind of impressed. So if I now put it, it's like, you know, mm-hmm. in my resume, it's gonna like, you know, what is she talking about? And it's like a common thing.
Right.
But at that time, it was something new.
Okay. So. Well, I think I understand your question. If the training is a little bit outdated, should you put that in your resume?
Right.
Well, I mean, you know your field. In the IT world, it's very cutting edge. It's very much about being fresh. So if you think it's not going to help you or make a case for you, I would consider leaving it out. However, it does show that at the time you were very eager to learn and keep fresh, you know? And that's something you can incorporate in your cover letter and just mention you're always, you know, interested in keeping current and retraining and retooling and taking classes without mentioning what it was. So that would be my first thought. Okay. Yes, sir.
I think I have this worded in my head now.
Okay.
Over the career working at the bank that I worked, one department for the majority of my year there. It dealt with using a lot of paper. All of a sudden, the world became green. The bank decided we're going to outsource this. So they pretty much took away my kingdom from me. That's what I called it. I was manager of that for over 25 years. And I did a very good job. I received a lot of citations, a lot of awards, a lot of thank you notes. And because the two or three areas after, every department that I went to eventually became outsourced because the technology just grew so fast that there was no need for it. So it was like, well, where do we put Kevin now? Now, I have that on my resume. Every department that I worked in, the amount of years, what my achievements were, what the accomplishments were, you know. Like this young lady mentioned, you know, encrypting a file, zipping a file. Right. Yeah, 12 years ago, that might have been a big deal. But right now, it isn't. 25 years ago, there used to be print room departments in every bank downtown. That's no longer the case. So how do you incorporate that into a resume when that was your major function for 25 of the 30-something years that you were working there? Because if I was to eliminate all that, what did this guy do for 33 years?
Here's the key thing you just said to me, your major function. Now, it seemed to me this student, that wasn't her major function. It was like an extra piece. But if that was your major function, and especially if you're in your industry, people understand about outsourcing and sustainability measures and so forth. So generally speaking, I would think that, especially if you're pursuing another position in your field, they would have an understanding of what has happened in the banking industry in the last decade or so. But if it's a major function of your position, by all means, have that in your resume, in my opinion. Some of the little technical details you might want to rephrase, you know, perhaps some things aren't necessarily needed to be mentioned. Think of how will each bullet point that you're including connect to that next job's title, that next job's role. Will it transfer over? That's really what you have to ask. It's a very specific thing. It's very much unique to someone in your position. So if it's a major part, of course, don't get rid of it. It's celebrate it, you know. You did a great job. Obviously, for 25 years, you've been helping this organization with these various things, and things change. But I would celebrate it and own it, and just show them the transferable aspects of those things that you did. So I hope that kind of answers your question. So I thought it was a little bit different from your question. I thought what she did with the zip file, that there's a little bit of extra training that shows, she, you know, at that time you're up to date, you know something special, but it wasn't a major component of her job. If it's a major component, definitely have it, okay? So before we end, we still have to talk about a very important aspect. Equally important to the resume is the cover letter, okay? If you look in your packet, it's second to last page. And this is also on our website under resources. You can see we've got an internship version, and actually on page 14 we have a basic cover letter example as well. So if you look at page 14, this is not to scale. And here's a zoom in on our screen of a basic cover letter. 10 years ago, people would write very short cover letters. At least that's what I've been hearing and seeing. Maybe a little paragraph introducing the resume. But what has really changed, I think, is the level of care you really should put into your cover letter. And I know looking for a job is a job, and this is something that should really be tailored. You know, I talk about tailoring the resume to the employer's needs and how they might be looking at, you know, how they're looking for candidates, but this is so important. Spend a good amount of time creating a cover letter and really think about how this is showing your passion for your job, for what you want to do, what you hope to accomplish at this next organization. So we've broken it up into three or four sections, okay? And of course, they're essential. They need to be tailored. It brings life to your resume. It makes a connection between your skills, your personality, your education and experience. You can incorporate those adaptive, transferable, job-related skills in there. You can even take it to another level and provide a concrete example, that star example. But what's most important, and I come back to this, what do you know about that organization's needs, their goals? How could you be a solution? How could you be an asset? So think about that in a broad way. And how do we find out? Research, research, research. Whether it's online, at the library, or through talking to people on LinkedIn, social media, really seeing trends and what's going on in the community and what that organization serves. It takes a little bit of work, but it's much more easier now. We've got, you know, Google and so forth in our phones. So there's no excuse not to research. And this will help you when you get the interview, right? So a cover letter is written in a business style format. It's typically 3 to 4 short paragraphs. Again, the art of it is to be concise yet share enough to be a teaser, to want them to see you, you know, bring you in for that interview. Always try to address a real human being. Try to find their name. I know sometimes it's quite difficult, but do your best to do some research on who is the hiring manager or who is the human resource director. Names make a connection. If you absolutely can't, you've tried and you tried, then dear hiring manager, dear human resource director is okay. It's okay. But I would encourage you to really think about the person it's going to. You're going to vary your writing style. It is first person. The I, you speak in terms of yourself in this document. And of course, you're going to sign it. You can also include a JPEG, an image of your signature, if you're emailing it. That's another step that takes it to another level. Or you can simply use a cursive style font if you'd like. Here we didn't do either, and that's okay as well. So typically, let's look at three sections. Let's start off with that. Dear Mr., Dr., Ms., whoever that is, we're starting it off that way. And we have an opening, section one. Section one, and the handout gives you a guide that matches up with each paragraph right here. Section one is the opening. Which position are you applying for? Okay. Where did you hear about it? And you can quickly drop a little hint as to why you're an asset. Here, Roberto is applying for a communication associate position at a magazine, I believe, a publication company. And he simply says, this is the specific position I'm applying for. It's tailored to this specific job. He says where he saw it on the website, and quickly leads right into my background in writing, research, and web design make me highly qualified for the position. And then we see why, okay? So if you look up here, section two is something that could be called a 30-second commercial. Remember, you're the product, your skills are the product. And essentially we're gonna talk about why should I be interested in you? What interests you about this organization, this position, You can incorporate some of your skills. And this is really where we see your personality, in your voice. If you'd like, you can add a star example. If you tell them, I'm known as somebody who's really innovative, then give them an innovative example. For example, I created ABC, program. And earlier, Kevin, you mentioned schmooze. And yes, that's our term we use on here as well. Schmooze. It's not so much schmoozing as it is an honest, genuine understanding. An understanding of what you know about them. What do you know about that organization? And what do you know about yourself that's going to connect the two? You know, the skills that you have, how will it be a benefit? So what you can see in the second paragraph, he talks about what he did, a little bit about his skills and the diverse audiences. And then we get down to the bottom. He's saying, I was very excited to see the amount of press that Arise offers to their constituents. He talks about the pleasing layout, diverse cutting edge topics, and so forth. So yeah, you are showing them what you know. And where's the best place to start? Most companies have a website. Most larger, mid-sized companies have a website. Even smaller places have at least a Facebook page or a social media presence, we hope. Look at their vision statement, their mission statement. And go above and beyond that if you really want to go a little deeper. Look at what articles have been written about it. I've been following Coca-Cola Company on LinkedIn to see what their trends are. Think outside of the box as far as your research as well, okay? And then we close with a simple, confident but humble ending, a final paragraph. I would greatly enjoy having an opportunity to speak with you further regarding my qualifications for this position. I can be reached at, and you reiterate your phone number and your email address. So we're not pleading for the opportunity, and I don't think it's wise necessarily to say, I will be contacting you on Thursday. You know, that's very bold, And if you feel comfortable doing that, that's your decision. But I think something like this is a little more balanced. And we're just gonna thank them for the time and consideration. Sign it and check both documents carefully. One other piece that you will need is your reference sheet. We no longer put references available upon request in your resume because it takes up too much space, frankly. You should have references available. You don't necessarily need to mail it in. When you apply for a job, but oftentimes they're asking you for references anyway in your application. So I'd like you all to think about three people who are professionals, who you've known in a professional context, can speak well of your abilities. Who are your cheerleaders? Who are your career champions? Who can articulate your skills? And it's harder when you work for yourself or you are at the top, but also consider subordinates. Consider people who are clients and other people who can attest to your work ethic, your management style, customer service, and so forth. And you want to start doing that early in the game. And that's not something you stop doing. You nourish those connections and networks and keep them alive. Yes?
The references that you're referring to, should you forewarn them that you may be getting a phone call from a prospective?
Absolutely. First we should ask. Yes, first we should absolutely ask permission. Will you speak positively about this? And what you should do is you should empower your reference. Give them your resume, give them the job description. Because sometimes we don't know you in the whole context. You know, I may know some wonderful aspects working with you in one way, but not the whole picture and where you're looking to go. And when you give a reference, when you use them as a reference, the employer can ask more detailed questions, which is different from just listing your supervisor as your, you know, contact. May we contact your supervisor? You're giving permission that they can learn more by contacting these people. So think of at minimum three people, maybe five. You're going to have a similar header. Let's see, the very last page. We've done that here. Keep the same header format that you have on your resume, and give us a call at 708-974-5737. You may also email us at jrc@morainevalley.edu. We are on our website as well. Our website is morainevalley.edu/jrc. We are also on Facebook. So if you are on Facebook or Twitter, we post a lot of job opportunities on that. So become familiar with that, and we can talk about your resume, we can talk about social media, different things to help your job search and your strategies, okay? So any other questions? I'm gonna go ahead and conclude for our audience viewing at home or in class. So thank you for listening. And again, please give us a call if you have any questions. Thank you.